Cunning. Okay. Oh, sorry. Give me just one second. I forgot one thing.
Yeah.
To record the audio separately, or
I'll just back up.
Ah,
yeah. Let's see. I've never done this one before. Okay, that's good now. Okay, so. Would people want to use this room today?
No, not today.
Okay.
Today's just software people, so they don't do electronics.
Okay. Oh, it's working on updates. Yeah. Why does it do that? I wish it gave me an option. Like, do this later.
Yeah. Are you otherwise happy with your laptop?
Yeah. It's not the most powerful one, but I got it considering the trade-offs. Like, it's really light.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So do you use it as a tablet or?
Both.
Yeah.
Yeah. I wanted to. I got this because it has a stylus as well, so I could, you know, draw.
Ah, right.
But then, I ran out of the battery ended. And I can't find an AAAA battery anywhere.
Four A's.
Yeah, four A's. So that's a little bit tricky.
Yeah.
Yeah, I've been all around Aalborg looking, couldn't find it.
You know, why didn't get one? I guess you have to order it online or something.
Oh man, yeah. That was one thing I didn't think about when I bought this.
Yeah.
Okay, so, I should tell you again why I'm doing this project.
Yeah.
So, basically, as I'm traveling across Europe, as I mentioned before, I'm collecting the stories of hackers, and this is basically a private project of mine, and I started it because back in Singapore with the DIY bio people, I realized after a while that we didn't collect a lot of documentation, so when we look back, it didn't seem like we did anything.
Yeah,
that's one thing. Or like, you know, pictures are missing, videos are missing.
Yeah,
and the other thing is that. A lot of time when we talk about the history of hacking anywhere in the world, it always refers to American history of hacking. So now I'm trying to just shift the discourse a little bit.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that's basically why I'm doing it. Yeah. And this video, this interview will probably be put up somewhere online, probably YouTube. And I don't know, you know, people can do whatever they want to it, I guess. As an archival document, that's what you use it for.
So you put it on some Creative Commons license?
Yeah. Very, very likely. Actually, yeah, the Creative Commons. What is that? The one where you attribute.
Yeah.
Okay, so you can stop me at any point. If there are things that are too sensitive, you can tell me to cut it out.
Yeah.
The other thing that we do is if there's something that's sensitive but it's important, sometimes we put an embargo on it and say like, okay, this part you can't publish until 5 years later, something like that.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay, so we begin. So I googled you a little bit, and you are now assistant professor in the computer science department in Aalborg University.
I was until like a week ago.
Mm.
I just recently got a new job.
Oh, okay.
So now I work in the private industry as a software developer.
Right, right.
So, but until then, I had been at the university for, I guess, 6 years of employment and 5 or 6 years of studies or something like that.
Mm. Right. And so what are you doing now?
So now I do software. I develop software.
Okay.
At a private company.
Any area in particular?
It's within the area of like cybersecurity.
Oh, okay. Right,
so.
Right. Okay. And how did you get into programming?
Well, I guess I started at a quite early age. So I inherited a computer from one of my uncles and started playing with it and playing games. And at some point so it was like an old computer, like an Amstrad, it's called. So it's from the same time period as the Commodore.
Mm.
So you sort of really had to know what to do in order to play games on it.
Mm-hmm.
So it sort of started with, yeah, just doing some really stupid things on that one, and then I graduated to some Windows 95 computer and doing some
mm-hmm.
of your basic stuff.
Mm.
Yeah. And then, yeah, I took an education as a computer scientist.
Okay. And what's it like going to school here for computer science?
Well, that depends on what kind of school you mean. So I mean so in Denmark the schooling system is free, well, basically all the way. But so in primary school, it's like 9 years of primary school,
mm-hmm.
basically. And well, when I was in primary school, we didn't have a lot of computers, so actually we got a few computers, and I sort of helped set them up, and we got some money from the principal to make a network and stuff like that.
Yeah.
So in yeah.
Like, your class got the money from the principal, or?
No, basically. So, I think the school had a few computers, and then me and a friend, we like sort of volunteered to spend some weeks of the summer holiday setting up this network,
mm.
if we could get the money for it. So we sort of got the money for it,
mm.
and then one of the teachers who was responsible for the computers sort of helped out. And
mm.
yeah.
And what was the environment like? Are most people very literate in computing in primary school?
So when I was in primary school, not really. I mean, because it was sort of so I was in primary school in like the early 90s, or I started at least in the early 90s, and at that point it was more like learning to do word processing and spreadsheets and stuff like
mm-hmm.
that. And well, the teachers didn't really know a lot about these computers and stuff, so at that time it was not something that people were really into. But I mean, in recent years it has become more of a requirement for basically any position.
Mm.
Mm. yeah, so what people are quite literate with computers, at least using them,
mm.
not necessarily hacking them or programming them.
Mm. But back then, how did you learn about these things if, you know, around you people were not really knowledgeable with it?
So I mean, so it started with like Microsoft had this like video CD-ROM course, like learn Visual Basic basically, and
mm-hmm.
and I got that and well basically looked through all of it more or less, and then more or less at that time the internet became something you could actually access as a well regular person, or you could I mean, so the school got some kind of modem internet connection at some point. And then from that point on, basically information was like available online
mm.
in various forms.
pretty smooth then, the journey to becoming a programmer.
Yeah, I mean, I've known for quite a long time that I wanted to, be a computer scientist.
Mm. When did that thought occur to you to become a computer scientist?
Well, I don't know, maybe in like the 7th grade or something.
Mm.
So, yeah, I mean, quite early, I would say.
How did you hear the term?
Well, I had one uncle who worked as a system administrator and another uncle who worked as a programmer at that time, and
mm.
so I sort of knew a little bit about it because, well, they said some things, but I mean, yeah, and then it was more like I found it really interesting that you
mm.
could make these machines do like complicated things.
Mm. So did your uncles help you with anything?
Well, not a lot as far as I remember, but I mean, it sort of, it really helped that they had like old gear that
mm.
I sort of inherited.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. And what kind of projects are you working on here in Hal9K? How do you pronounce it? Do you say Hal9000?
So in Danish we say Hal9K.
Hal9K.
And in English I don't think we have a pronunciation, but Hal9K is fine.
Okay.
So basically it's like Hagerlab 9000, because 9000 is the postal code
mm.
of Aalborg. So I guess you could say Hal9000, but nobody would probably understand. Yeah.
Mm.
So I mean, it's sort of like it basically, when I'm in the hackerspace, I mostly work on like electronics related projects actually.
Mm-hmm.
So I mean, of course, most electronics projects these days, they have quite a large bit of software in them, because it's normally something like you have a few components to control the electronic stuff and then the microcontroller, because that's like the easy stuff, right? So that's basically how you do a CNC machine or a 3D printer or basically anything, right? So I mean, when I'm in the hackerspace, I normally do like electronics related projects
mm.
or hardware related projects where we use like the workshop machines and stuff like that. Because I mean, in my daily job, especially now, I do quite a lot of software, so yeah, it's mostly here I do like projects that are more connected to the real world in a direct fashion.
Mm-hmm. So you work in this room a lot, in the other room?
Yeah, or in the common room, or it sort of depends, but yeah, I generally use some of the electronic tools we have.
What kind of projects are these? I saw you had one.
So, I mean, one project I've been working on is, of course, building a 3D printer.
Okay.
And this, well, it takes quite some time, and you sort of, I got it up and running, so now it's sort of working, and now I'm preparing to take it apart and do a bunch of upgrades to it.
Mm.
So that's one project I've been spending some time on.
Building a 3D printer from scratch?
Yes, basically. So it's Ultimaker 2, but a clone of that. So basically some guy on Thingiverse, he took the Ultimaker 2 drawings, the official open source CAD drawings,
mm.
and he ripped out all the, more or less all the custom parts and replaced it with these aluminium extrusion profiles. So basically you sort of get like the box from the aluminium profiles, and then, well, if you build it exactly according to specification, then you basically get the same mechanics as an Ultimaker 2. Yeah. So I'm building a, well, slightly changed, not in the mechanical sense, but like a different extruder, a different hot end and things like these, small details.
Mm. And there was a project that I saw on the Hal9K Hal9K website. You wrote about tracking electricity in your house, I think, was it? In the fall of the
yes.
Day?
So One of my other ongoing projects is like a home monitoring, a home automation project. So I have built a number of sensors. So basically they're like an Arduino and an Ethernet controller and a temperature and humidity sensor.
Mm.
And then I have a few of those around my house, so I can like measure the temperature and humidity like over time.
Mm.
And then I have a battery backup system for all these devices. So basically I have my home network, which is like Ethernet, and then I power all the devices with power or Ethernet. And then I have like a central UPS somewhere, which has a battery backup. And then I have this server where I keep all the graphs. So one of the graphs I have is like the voltage of the system.
Mm.
And what I was wondering was that it seemed that there was like this pattern in the voltage that basically during the day, the voltage would be, I think, slightly increased, as far as I remember, relative to like the voltage at night.
Mm.
So it was, I mean, not like a big difference, but like a few millivolts of difference or something. But it was sort of like noticeable enough that it had to be some sort of effect. So
mm.
So basically we had like a big discussion on our chat service in Hal9K.
Mm.
Nobody, I mean, so there were like a lot of proposals, like whether it was like the photoelectric effect of like the sun hitting some LEDs and inducing a voltage, or
mm.
yeah, something like that. So I mean, in the end we didn't really find an answer, and then I sort of documented on the blog post to sort of see if somebody had an idea.
Mm.
And I think my current theory is that it is probably one of the cameras I have that has like an infrared light that it
mm.
turns on at night. So I think that's one of the theories that was suggested. And I think that's probably it. But
okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was really curious as well. I was looking at it going, what?
Yeah.
That's interesting.
Yeah, and it's sort of like you can't really, I mean, it was really like a very minute difference. So it wasn't something that you could like observe, but I mean, in the beginning I sort of just had like one day and I was like, that's odd.
Mm.
The voltage seems different in periods. And then it's sort of like the process of trying to figure out what is the cause of this difference. And yeah, I mean, one big step forward, I think, was when somebody suggested that it was following like the sun, so that when the sun was shining, it was correlating with this voltage difference. And,
yeah.
I mean, so because before that, I had no idea.
Mm.
So that was a fun discussion, with I think a reasonable explanation in the end. But
mm.
Yeah.
Okay, and so you co-founded this hackerspace.
Yes.
How did that happen?
Well, it sort of, so we were some people who knew each other who had been talking about like, why don't we have a hackerspace in Aalborg, because it was around the time where the hackerspace in Copenhagen was started. So we sort of knew that there was something going on, and we sort of knew like what the concept was, and we thought, why don't we have such a thing in Aalborg? So we were some people who met once or twice in a bar and talked about like how awesome it would be, basically, and tried to like get people interested in this and finding out how big the interest was in having such a hackerspace.
Mm.
So we were quite lucky because we sort of got a contact through a guy, so we got in contact with, or well, he was in contact with the municipality,
mm.
which has a number of rooms around town, basically for these. So what's it called in English? Like these volunteer groups, basically.
Mm.
So there's this concept of a forening, which is quite common in Denmark, which basically is like, any sort of group of people that has like bylaws. And then the municipality has to offer some rooms that are sort of like suitable. But in the end, so we found out that actually these rooms were free. And we were allowed to use them for like 1 or 2 months or something like that. So we couldn't like make it permanent, but we quite quickly got a place where we could actually meet. And so we met a few times here and did some things. I mean, at that time we didn't have any tools or any equipment or any money for that.
Was this the place by the docks?
We started in these here actually.
Here.
Yes.
Oh, okay.
But we were only allowed given the room for a few months.
Mm.
So we sort of had a few months so we could start. Collecting money so people could start paying the dues. And then we were looking for like a more permanent place, and there was some rooms near the harbor. An old office building that was going to be torn down at some point. I think initially we were promised like in a 1 year guarantee at least, but that was better than 2 months. So we sort of took that because it was sort of central. It was quite easy to get to from the inner city, but because it was in this old industrial harbor area, it was also remote enough that people wouldn't mind if we were doing like noisy stuff and stuff like that. And there were quite a lot of rooms there, quite a lot of square meters. But, well, I wouldn't call it a downside, but we had to share it with some other people, some other groups, basically. And initially we had some big ideas that we could have common tools between the different groups, and it would be awesome, and we could like share a lot of the facilities and share a lot of the maintenance costs. But, well, unfortunately, quite quickly, the hackerspace sort of grew to be like the biggest group within that building, and the other groups were sort of like very small compared to the hackerspace. And because of the way the agreements were made, it was sort of like disproportionately expensive for us to be there compared to what we were getting, and we had to take quite a lot of care of like the maintenance and stuff like that. So around that time I was actually going to Australia for half a year, so I wasn't there when we moved to these buildings again. But at some point we were talking to the municipality again and talking about finding a more permanent place, because we were still only there for a limited period of time near the harbour. And initially we were promised we had 1 year at the harbour, and then it was made until 2 years. But the building was sort of like, I mean, it was half of the building was already torn down, which meant that the central heating system was gone. And basically, because half of the building was gone, there was quite a lot of walls that were not insulated. And the other way to heat the building was using electricity, which is quite expensive. So basically, we would like to find something more permanent before the winter at that point. We got these rooms, or this building, basically. But now we have it as permanently as you can have these municipality rooms, which basically means that Well, as long as the municipality doesn't get any other ideas for the rooms, then we can have them. So now we have been here for, I guess, like 2 or 2 years or 2.5 years or something like that. And we have spent quite some money in like customizing the building and remodeling some rooms. So we tore down some walls and put on some other walls. We moved things around a few times to better suit our needs. Initially we had one set of machines, and now we have a very different set of machines. So now we have like the workshop is split up, and like the 3D printers have moved into closer proximity to people, basically. Where before we had like a room just for 3D printers, but yeah. So at the moment we're using all the space we have here, basically, but I don't think we will get any better rooms anytime soon. I think it's I think it's quite nice and quite suiting at the moment, at least.
Okay, you mentioned that back by the harbor, the hackerspace grew quite fast in terms of membership.
Yeah.
How many people was there at that time?
So I can't really remember. I guess we had like 20 or 30 members or something like that. So that's like we count like regular paying members. And then there are a few people who sort of like hang around sometimes, but not not on any regular basis. So I think we had like 20 or 30 people at the old buildings, maybe more growing towards 40 in the end. And at the moment we're like we have 50 paying members, which is quite stable actually for quite some time. So it's sort of like some people move away from town, so like students graduating and things like that, and then some new people find us and become members. So it's quite stable at around 50 members, which is totally fine.
Who were the other two groups in the same building at the time?
So there was a bit of like a changing of the groups, but basically I would say they were more like art oriented groups, so focused more on like doing things for art purposes, but I can't really remember who were there. So at some point, there were some game developers who were there for a few months at one point. But the other big group down there, the group that sort of had the buildings to start with is called this Platform 4, which is an old. It's sort of hard to categorize, but at that point it was sort of like a creative space / bar / concert area, and basically we got along quite well with those guys because they were not using the building that much, and we didn't really have any conflicts. It was just that we were paying quite a lot for having the facilities compared to what we were getting, basically.
But at some point it was free, right? Was it?
No, not really.
I thought just as I said, the municipality gives like free rooms to.
No, the municipality has to offer rooms at a quite low price, but it's sort of like it's not like a straightforward deal because so Aalborg municipality is like quite big, like I don't know, maybe at least 50 kilometers from one end to the other, and basically the deal is that they have to offer rooms somewhere in the municipality, which basically means that they can fulfill their obligation just by offering rooms like in some small town like 20 kilometers from the city center or something like that.
Okay.
So basically it's sort of like a dialogue with them anyway.
Yeah.
But we're quite happy here.
Mm.
You have we saw quite some different options at one point, but these facilities suit us quite well, because I mean it could be closer to the center of town, but yeah, you can always wish for that. But at least we have like regular bus service, and
it's quite bad that I can come here by bus.
Yep.
Yeah. Takes only 25-30 minutes.
Yeah.
Okay, so other than membership fees, how are you guys funding yourselves at the moment?
So we have like the membership fees, which is the majority of our income, and then we have a few like regular donations from workers unions.
Mm-hmm.
Horsa has been one of our early supporters to this. They are a workers union for IT workers. And more recently, the engineers workers union has also started doing a regular donation.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but other than that, I mean, we don't have any sources of income. I mean, sometimes when we want to buy like a bigger machine, we try to apply for funding, but it's been quite a while since we did that. So at the moment it's primarily membership fees, and then secondarily donations.
Mm-hmm. Prosa also chips in for funding.
Yes.
Right.
So I think they sponsor what the equivalent of like two members a month.
Mm-hmm. Why do they find it necessary to chip in?
I don't know if they find it necessary, but I mean they have been like sponsoring us from more or less the very beginning.
Okay.
So we don't really promise anything back. I mean, I guess they do it for the exposure, but you really had to ask them, I think, as to what their motives are, if they have any. Yeah.
I'm just wondering, is it a, like you say, a publicity thing, or is it goodwill?
I would guess that it is.
The pasta is
okay. And speaking of Prosa, it's an IT workers union.
Mm-hmm.
Mainly because I transported it from home.
Sorry,
maybe you should close the door.
Yeah.
And because it's gluten free, so it doesn't stick together.
They won't mind, right?
No, I think I just need to make sure that they don't eat all the pasta. I need to have some of it.
Oh, right. You want to tell them first?
What?
You want to tell them not to eat all the pasta?
No.
Yeah, I can't work on an empty stomach.
Yeah.
That's for sure. Okay, yeah, where were we? Right, Prosa, IT Workers Union. Well, as a union, I suppose they would do a lot of things, including step in when there are disputes. Has any sort of such thing happened in Aalborg?
Not that I'm aware of.
Right.
So I mean, they're not really involved with like the day to day business of the hackerspace. They are just putting, they're just giving a regular donation basically, and well, not getting anything agreed in return basically. But I mean, there is some alignment of goals. They have like these technical talks and things like that, which is basically aligned with what we're interested in a lot of the time.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, that's basically
and I think mentioned before as well that they because I asked about crypto parties.
Yeah.
And so Hal9K doesn't do much of that, right? And it's Prosa that does that.
Yeah, so Prosa has within their student organizer committee, they have been doing these IT evenings with like an evening on open source and like an evening on crypto, yeah, crypto party basically. And it's sort of like it's also interesting for a lot of the members in Hal9K basically. And I mean, yeah, sometimes we contribute or yeah, at least talk with some people what's going on. But no, Hal9K doesn't do any like regular talks. We sometimes try to get something started, but it's yeah, you need to have like talkers who have like a subject and are willing to give a presentation basically. But it's yeah, and it's usually quite some work in tracking down people who are willing to do a talk and getting them to do it and getting the announcement and things like this.
Yeah, I haven't really checked out ProSci yet, but I was just wondering where what is their position in organizing activities around Aalborg, and where does like do they do let's say crypto parties and then Hal9K looks at what is lacking and then steps in and organizes something along what is lacking.
No, I think so. They have quite a number of activities in Aalborg, like mostly centering around the students, because Aalborg is quite a big educational town. And so I know they have some talks at the university, at least at the computer science department. But it, I mean, basically, we're Hal9K is not really involved in that, except if we're asked if we could give a talk on some subject, and then we try to help basically. I don't know. Probably not.
Okay. Alright, where were we? Okay, and so what was the first hackerspace in Denmark? Was it the one in Copenhagen?
Yes, I'm pretty sure it was the one in Copenhagen, Labitat. I don't know their entire history, but I'm pretty sure they were different.
And after that would be here or Aarhus?
I'm not quite sure. I think maybe we were the second hackerspace. I think we were before Aarhus, but I'm not sure.
Okay. And you guys were, you mentioned you guys were just a bunch of friends meeting in a pub talking about this.
Yeah.
Right. And why did you want a hackerspace? Was it just to, you know, get all this infrastructure and build stuff?
I can't really remember. I mean, I think we were talking about like cool projects that we would be able to do. And it was around the time where 3D printing started to become like accessible. So we were, I guess we were talking about how awesome it would be to have like 3D printers and CNC machines and things like that. And awesome and weird projects one would be able to do. But I can't really remember what we talked about like concretely.
And how does the general public come to know about Hal9K right now? Do you guys do outreach?
Mostly by word of mouth, I would say, and Facebook. So we have at like different points in time tried to do some outreach towards the university and well also towards the general public, but not any real focused effort because it's I think our experience is mostly that the amount of new members we get for the effort we have to put into it is well not really worth it. compared to the people who like sort of come to know us because of word of mouth or because they see our Facebook posts.
Mm.
So we don't really have any like marketing strategy at the moment, except we try to post on Facebook when we do awesome things, and try to attract some attention there. And it's, I think it's working quite well, because then the technically interested people and their friends will sort of see it.
Mm. Okay. And how does Hal9K see itself? Does it see itself as some sort of you know, mover and shaker of things, and want to drive getting people to code and hack? Or does it take more like a laid-back approach?
I think we have a much more laid-back approach, that we see ourselves as a technical workshop, basically.
Mm.
So we don't really... I mean, it's not totally correct, but I mean, at some, in one interpretation, we don't really care about what people are doing.
Mm.
We're just caring about providing people with the tools and the knowledge and the means to do what they want to do.
Mm.
So I mean, there are some members who have some interests. So some people are interested in reusing electronics, for example, for like environmental purposes, and well, other members don't care as much about that as others, but yeah, so it's sort of hard to agree on like a big project within the member community, except I mean trying to have like awesome tools and awesome opportunities, basically.
Mm.
So that's mostly been where we have our focus. So not a very idealistic way of running a hackerspace, I guess. But yeah, I mean, in a way, if people want to do idealistic things, then they're definitely free to do them.
Does Hal9K and its members have connections with the other hackerspaces across Denmark or around the world?
Mostly, I mean, so we have mostly been meeting with the hackerspace in Aarhus and Labitat in Copenhagen, but mostly at like Mega Fairs. So quite recently we have started, or some of our members have started organizing a summer camp together with the hackerspace in Aarhus. So that's one of our first collaboration projects.
Mm-hmm. When did this summer camp start?
It will be in August, and I think it will be announced like in a week or two or something like that.
When was the first time it started, I mean?
I guess some weeks ago with one guy who wanted to have a summer camp, basically.
Oh, so this will be the first summer camp?
Yes.
Right. How did that happen?
Well, one guy wanted to have a summer camp, so he had been to these hacker camps in Germany and in the Netherlands, like Hackers at Random and Ohm and things like this.
Mm-hmm.
He wanted something similar in Denmark.
Mm. Someone from Hal9K?
Yes.
Right. And he just reached out to Argus and...
Yes, basically.
Okay. August. Okay. Let's see. And of course, since we are approaching this topic as well, I read that in that Jonas Zacho Müller and Lina Simone Bergstrom MA thesis that you sent to me.
Yeah.
And there was a thesis that talked in part about Hal9K as well. I'm not sure whether I got it correctly because I was translating with, you know, Google Translate.
Yeah.
But I think there was one part where they said Hal9K tends to stay away from politics. I'm not sure whether I'm
maybe
getting that.
So basically it was a pair of anthropology students who were doing a I think it was their master thesis on like the hackerspaces or maker culture in Denmark or something like that. So they interviewed some members in Hal9K, and some members, I think, also in Aarhus and in Copenhagen as well. I can't remember, I don't think I've actually read it in detail. But I think you could probably be right that, I mean, compared to a place like L'Habitat, which I think is, well, they're more focused on like being independent, for example, where Hal9K is more, well, yeah, if somebody wants to give us like free tools, then yeah, let's talk about it, basically.
But it's in terms of funding, then, independent in that sense.
Yeah.
So you would, for example, have sponsors and put up their logos on the website and things like
yeah.
that. But that's something that other hackerspaces are doing as well, right? And
yeah.
And here's where maybe I'm not very sure whether I got them right, but would it be correct to say that Hal9K is more aloof about things like surveillance, privacy, that sort of issue.
So could you rephrase that?
You know, like privacy and security and surveillance is currently really, really big, right?
Yeah.
As a topic, especially after the Edward Snowden revelations. And of course, across the world, hackers and software developers and others are quite upset about it, and they express a lot about it. They hold activities and workshops about it.
Yeah.
So I'm just wondering whether Hal9K gets involved in this sort of issues. There has maybe a slight activist slant to it.
No, not Hal9K. I mean, some of our members might, but I think, I mean, I can't remember if it is in our bylaws that we are apolitical or if it's just like generally agreed upon, but it is something like that. So, yeah, I mean, yeah, it's, I don't think it's anything that we, I mean, we don't have, Hal9K doesn't have like a general opinion on a lot of things. So we, in our bylaws, we more talk about getting people interested in technology and enabling them to use these advanced forms of technologies that are becoming available. And not as much about politics, basically.
So it's really about access to tools and some sort of empowerment.
I would say that's basically the focus. I mean, we try to be the workshop for people who live in a small apartment or don't have the money to buy a lot of tools. And we try to be the workshop for these kinds of people.
Okay. And is it a kind of a very conscious choice to avoid the politics and just focus on this, or?
No, not really. I mean, it's more, yeah, I mean, if somebody tried to start like a movement within Hal9K to, like, if somebody, for example, said that I think Hal9K should have an opinion on this subject, then they would be free to try to convince some people that we should have an opinion on this. And I mean, we have our general assembly and we have our board meetings where our members could do such a thing. So I think it's more a question that nobody has been interested in this enough, at least. It's not that I mean, opinions about surveillance is, well, I know that some of our members have opinions about surveillance, definitely. It's just not something that there has been any need for Hal9K to have an opinion on, basically.
Yeah, just curious about that. And you know, it's quite interesting as well, because in the other hackerspaces I've been to, like let's say Berlin Lab or the ones in Berlin, you see stickers everywhere. Stickers of all kinds of startups and programming language communities, and then you also have, things about surveillance and all that. But over here, and I noticed in Labitat as well, it tends to be very clean. Like people don't really use stickers here. Is that a thing?
I don't know,
like to keep their
stickers.
Laptops
I guess it's not as big a thing in Denmark.
Danish aesthetic, I suppose.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I think we have some stickers, and if somebody came and asked, we could probably find one for their laptop, but it's, yeah.
Okay. I thought that was curious.
Yeah, I think it's a good observation. I haven't noticed that, for example.
Okay. Yeah, that came to mind because yeah, I was seeing all these stickers of Snowden and Chelsea Manning and whoever else elsewhere. Yeah. Okay, so what about the general perception about hacking and making in Aalborg? Do people understand what the word means, or do you find that when you talk to people hacking, they say, "Oh, and the criminal stuff"? Is that
I think. I think most relevant people know that there are different sorts of hacking and that all forms of hacking are illegal. But it was something that we thought quite a lot about when we were naming the hackerspace and when we were doing our initial funding applications.
When you say you thought quite a lot, is it internal or with...
Yeah, internally. Because, I mean, if you're applying for a sponsorship, then you want them to read further than hacking, basically, if they think that hacking is a bad thing. So, I mean, I remember at one point, I guess in the very early days, there was quite some debate about what to name the thing and whether to call it like Hackspace 9000 or something like that. And well, part of the reason we went for Hal9K was basically that the word hack was not in it, so we were sort of avoiding that word to some degree. But yeah, I think most people who are like related to the hacker or maker culture, they know the difference nowadays. And there is quite a large alternative culture movement in Aalborg as well. Also, definitely giving credit to the Platform 4 place. They have been more or less like spearheading this alternative culture for quite some years. So there's quite some knowledge about hacking and making.
So generally, I mean, within the community, people would understand what hacking and making is.
Yeah.
But outside it, in general, what?
I mean, it depends on who you ask. I mean, if you ask culturally interested people, then I think they would know, generally.
Right. Okay. I still have problems when I talk about hacking. And sometimes I use the word kind of unconsciously. I would just say, "Oh, I'm going to the hackerspace," for example. Very innocuous kind of phrasing, and people I know who are not, into this,
they'll say,
"Oh my God, where are you going?" So I was just curious.
Yeah.
Well, what's it like over here? Okay. And. And about the activity of hacking itself, making stuff, is it big in Aalborg or not?
It could be bigger, and I think, most of our members are probably of the opinion that more people in Aalborg should be hacking, just be interested in like how all these devices and products that we surround ourselves with, how they work and what you can do with them instead of just consuming, basically. Yeah, so what I forgot the question.
Basically, for Albo,
Yeah.
at large,
Right.
is there interest in this hacking?
I think there is quite an interest, but people are also doing it in various different places. So, for example, several educations at the university have sort of like a workshop available for the students to use, but these are like very decentralized efforts. And then there's like a platform forum, which also has some facilities, and then there is Hal9K. And basically, there are also a few other older groups that were like predating like the maker movement, which you could also argue that they are doing some form of hacking or making. So I know there is a wood and metal workshop that's available somewhere, and there is also a group of radio amateurs who also do, well, electronic hacking basically. Except I don't know if they would say that is what they're doing, but yeah, they're definitely close to the definition of hacking or making.
What are these two groups called? Do you have the names?
Yes, so there's Experimental Danish Radio Amateurs, EDR.
EDR.
And then there's yeah, Platform 4, and then there's this wood workshop, which I'm not sure it's open at the moment, but it's this place called Huset.
Huset.
Yeah.
How do you spell
it? Huset.
Just that.
Yeah, so it just means the house in Danish, and it's also did like this. They have a cafe and they have some concerts and things, but yeah, a cozy place. And then at one point they also had a workshop. I'm not sure it's open at the moment.
I can probably find them online.
Yes, I think it's something like huset.dk.
So. Okay, and of course, speaking of the demographics, I asked before, but maybe I should ask again just for archival purposes, where are all the women?
Elsewhere. So, I mean, I think yeah, it's a general problem in the Danish culture that for some reason the girls are not that interested in the technological side of things. Or, I mean, in an education like computer science, there is only a few percent of the students that are women actually. And this is like a quite a general problem for some reason in the Danish society. And of course, in Hal9K, we also suffer from this. So basically, at the moment, we don't have any women. Why this is, it's very hard to say. And I'm yeah, not being in the group that we're talking about, I can only speculate. But I think it's some cultural thing that it's yeah, what it is exactly, I don't know. But I think it's a cultural thing because in I know in other countries, even in Europe, for example, the percentage of females in computer science education, for example, are not that low as they are in Denmark. So for some reason, it's this way. It's I mean, it's hard for a small place like Hal9K to change this. Well, yeah, we don't actively discourage females from being members, not at all. On the other hand, we don't do anything active to try to make the gender balance more balanced.
Have you ever had a woman in this group?
Yes, I think we had like one or two female members at some point. but not any, yeah, not any anything very regular.
So when was that, when you had these two women? Was it early on?
Yes, I think it was early on.
And they just stopped coming, or?
I don't know if they actually ever like became official members, but I mean they, yeah, I think they were around for a few evenings or something like that.
Just a few evenings.
Yeah.
Okay. Is there anyone I should speak to regarding gender and hacking in our world? Do you know?
Yeah, I mean that's a hard question. So I think the closest I could say is that I know the Department of Computer Science at the university has a been doing some things. So they had like a summer camp just for girls to get them interested in IT, or at least having them try it out. Yeah, I guess that's the closest. Maybe platform four could know somebody to talk to. I mean, I think they have a more balanced gender balance. On the other hand, they don't. I mean, they are a more diverse place, so they have like a cafe and concerts, and I would say that yeah, the making or the maker space is just a tiny portion of what they're doing.
And they attract a lot of people from the arts as well, I think.
Yes.
Whereas this place is more devoted to just happen making.
Yes. So we have had some well, art people come and get help for their projects. But it is more, at least in my experience, they are more interested in like the current project and not necessarily sticking around to like maintain the tools and these things, which is also okay, basically. I mean, as long as we can help some people do some stuff, then we're basically happy.
Oh, speaking on that, so it would be okay for people to just come in and ask for help and
Yeah, basically, I mean, every Thursday evening we have yeah, open night where everybody is allowed to come by. And yeah, if people have a problem, then normally someone is willing to help them with it, or at least guide them in the right direction.
Thanks for the Python file, by the way.
What?
The Python file.
Ah, did you get it to work?
Not yet.
No.
I might have to roll back to OpenCV 2.
Ah.
So I'm considering
Okay.
the option now.
Well, at least it worked for me,
Okay.
so I don't know.
Yes, I'm just wondering about the trade-offs. Like, should I stay with OpenCV 3 or should I go back to OpenCV
I have
2?
no idea.
Don't know. Right, so you mentioned the computer science department had a summer camp for women.
Yes.
Who's leading that one? Is there anyone I can speak with? Or
No, I don't know the details, but I can maybe find you a link or something. Yeah. I think somewhere inside the university somebody probably has an opinion on it, or several people have an opinion on it at least. But at least in the computer science department, there's I think there is it's generally acknowledged that it is a problem, but nobody has any idea what to do about it, basically.
I find it odd because considering that Denmark is well known for having better gender equality than other
Yeah.
spaces.
I mean it's and I mean there is a free choice. So it's not like yeah. And there are even statistics showing that actually the girls when they are in primary school and in high school as well, they're actually doing better in math than the boys are.
Mm.
Mm. But yeah, what it is exactly, I have no idea.
Mm.
And
mm.
I don't think, yeah. I mean, if somebody figures it out, then yeah, it would be good. But
mm.
I don't think it has a simple explanation.
Yeah. Well, I will investigate a little bit.
Yeah.
Okay. Let's see. I think one last question,
mm-hmm.
which is so in Indonesia and elsewhere, some groups reject the term hacker
mm-hmm.
or hackerspace, even though they do a lot of hacking, and that's because of well, they basically see the word hacker or hackerspace as a term invented by the West, and
mm-hmm.
and they already have traditions where they get together, repurpose things, make stuff,
mm-hmm.
and for them, it's a question of identity
mm-hmm.
and of history. And I was just wondering, is there a are there similar feelings here? Is there an indigenous Danish term
mm.
for hacking?
No, I mean, so I mean, I know for most of the people who were co-founding Hal9K, the word hacker was sort of like leading back to like the jargon file written by Eric Raymond, as far
mm-hmm.
as I remember. So that, like the I guess basically the definition of hacker from like the hackers of the 80s and the culture around MIT where that started out.
Mm.
I think quite some of our members would identify with that term and that origin of the word. As well as there is a Danish term for hacker. Well,
for making
yes
activities,
I mean not really. So there are like a term like klamphugger, but this basically means like a bad craftsman, basically
a bad craftsman,
yes, who hacks something together,
right.
I mean, I think that's the closest Danish term I could think of
mm-hmm.
of somebody who, yeah, just takes something and slams it together, basically.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think we have a term for, like, that covers the full aspect of hacking, of
mm-hmm.
using something not for its original purpose or something like that.
Mm-hmm. So what would you have called the person who makes stuff ingeniously, very cleverly before the word hacking came about?
I don't know. I mean, you would normally just talk about whether people is a good craftsman or bad craftsman.
Mm.
So, yeah. I think it would be something like a good craftsman or something like that. I don't think there is like a separate term for it.
Okay.
In Danish, at least.
Okay. What's the term for craftsman?
Håndværker. That basically means a person who is working with his hands or
okay.
her hands.
Right, I forgot. So you have a lab here, a bio lab?
Not really a bio lab, but somewhere where there's ventilation at least
mm-hmm.
for working with chemicals.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think anyone is actually doing biological experiments.
Mm-hmm.
On purpose, at least.
Yeah, we have a lot of accidental experiments in the fridge back home.
Yeah. We also have that.
Yeah. But I was just wondering, what was the impetus for setting up this bio or chemical?
The original incentive was some people would like to do analog photography.
Right.
And then you need some chemicals for developing films and pictures and stuff like that. So that was the original intent. And I'm not sure if anybody has actually done biohacking
In Aalborg.
In Aalborg, yeah.
Mm.
I know some people were talking about that at some point, but I don't think they ever got started.
Mm.
Sometimes it's more fun to talk about awesome projects than actually doing them.
Mm. And it does require a different set of apparatus as well.
Yeah.
Okay, I think that's it for now.
Yeah.
Well, thank you so much.
Yeah, no problem.
Yeah.
And if there's anything, just send me an email.
Okay, I'll do that.
I'll go and check if there's more food.
I hope there is some for you.
Yeah, it's okay. Oh, and if you need some work addresses or something like that, just send me an email and I'll figure them out.
Okay.
Yeah.
Oh, do you think I could get a tour of Hackerspace on camera of Hal9K and
Yes.
Maybe after you eat, I suppose?
Yeah.